the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker. I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.
Join us in our design movement.
Good evening, everyone. A warm welcome to this webinar. As you know, today we are going to talk of product design, trends, opportunities and challenges. My name is Hari Kara and I head the Department of Product Design at MIT Institute of Design. Today we have with us Parag Sen. He is an industrial designer as well, and he is the founder director of Cluster One Creative Solutions. It's a Pune based design consultancy, and he's a graduate from the University of New South Wales in Sydney, and then he started working in the industry, and he's set up his own studio which does wayfinding, product design and experience design, user experience design, mostly human machine interface from what I know, and his focus areas are defense applications, which is a very unique thing to have in the industry. Besides this, he's lately he started a company called, it's a startup, it's called Wayturn Systems, and it's a very unique concept because they have consumer analytics, they do consumer behavior analytics by means of location in a built environment. It's not outside, by navigation and location finding, wayfinding and so on. So yeah, as you know, so what I'll do is, from what we know, there could be people from having different understanding of product design. So if you don't mind, Parag, I'll quickly introduce to the audience to set a context of what product design is, and then we can start with trends.
If I can thank you for inviting me here.
Yeah,
it's okay. Very nice to be here. I'm looking forward to the chat with you.
Yeah, thanks, Parag. So, as many people might be, the definition of product design is quite broad in that sense. So, what we'll try and do is we'll try and stick to industrial product design. So, we are concerned with design of mass manufactured goods. Yeah. So, everything from a toothbrush to a toilet brush is not a good idea to say, but yeah, everything.
Computers.
But computers, maybe computers, everything in between. So it's essentially, it's the design of everyday objects. Yeah, so it can be consumer appliances, and it can be medical products, it can be furniture, it can be lighting, it can be lifestyle products. It's a broad domain. So what why we want to tell you is because we want to tell you what industrial designers do. So on one hand, they have to deal with technology, they have to do with materials manufacturing and so on. So there's quite a lot of science and technology, and on the other hand, they need to know human factors, they need to know empathy, they need to understand user experience and so on, right? And now there are more skills being added to this as we'll discuss right away. Yeah, so if you don't mind, we'll start with a discussion. I'll talk of the first trend. The first trend is smart products and IoT. Yeah, so to give you a background, as you know, most products today are becoming smart. That means there are a lot of integrated electronics, processors, memory, sensors and so on. So everything is getting connected, which we call Internet of Things, and the devices talk to each other today. So that's a trend which we've shared this between us. So can you highlight on that?
So what is happening is the delivery is getting more intelligent. The end user behavior is being onboarded on a dynamic basis. So So as the user uses the product or a service, we know his behavior and how the product is being used. So that feedback is being used to develop analytics and intelligence, which is improving our delivery system, as well as we are more sort of up and ready with modifications and customization of the product to be market ready and to get improvements out of the way as we move along. So it's a very dynamic sort of process, and this smartness is really, you know, helping us speed up the process of evolution, design and everything, all of that.
The smart is not only helping the user, but it's helping the customer, the company which makes the product, to understand the users better, so they can come with new ideas.
And opening up new vistas of work opportunity, because devices are becoming different, they are becoming intelligent, new avenues of technological evolution is taking shape, new systems are being designed, devices are now able to communicate with each other. So they have become smart in that nature. When they communicate with each other, they also give us the feedback from that communication, and we are more connected to the world now. We are used to the world of internets, which is downlinking from the satellites, but now we are getting used to the world which is linked up from the bottom up. So the devices are now interconnected and they have become more intelligent. So that's really the backbone of Internet of Things.
Correct. So like, you know, we've kind of graduated around the same time, and our yesteryears when we studied industrial design, we had to do mostly with form, function, maybe a little bit of electronics. But today, if we talk in with this trend, you know, what are the new skills that, you know, designers will have to acquire as industrial designers, because we have so much of electronics and smartness?
I would tend to look at the designer as a chef who blends different ingredients together, and the skill lies in how he blends the ingredients. The success of the recipe depends on his skill, and the challenge lies in how he blends those elements. Now we have a number of more elements on our palette. A designer has to deal with so much more now, so that blending skill has become a little more challenging. So he has to enhance his skills, he has to understand technology a little more, but I believe the upcoming generation is more attuned to
already
a technological world, a world driven by technology and gadgets. Our next generation, my kids or kid, the one kid that I have, is much more smarter than I used to be at that point of time in age. So they are very prepared. But yes, when you get into design education, that all becomes very systemized, and you have to acquire those skills to be able to blend all of these things together.
For example, Arduino programming, or you know, hardware programming, or understanding of sensors and all.
And these things are evolving very fast. And the control environment, you interfaces, and how do you deal with gadgets and your surroundings are all evolving very, very fast. So
that is so.
People get used to this new environment before the designers have to get used to the new environment. So in that sense, so design education is also, you know,
is evolving.
Evolving in that same direction.
Second most important trend, and it's not a trend, I think it's kind of forced, it's a need of the hour, I would say, is sustainability. Yeah, because we are all facing today the effects of climate change, and in, you know, the perils of industrialization and mass consumerism, and there's so much plastic. I think most people hate industrial designers for using so much plastic in their products. So How do we have to adapt to this change, and what do you think are the new challenges?
So we have to learn to live with plastic. So you can't live without brushing your teeth, and I don't see an alternative without the toothbrush in the near future.
Okay.
Yes, materials are changing. Maybe plastic will become a little more environment friendly also, but do we need plastic everywhere is a critical question. So government has recently banned single-use plastic, and companies will have to develop systems to deal with single-use plastic and discard the use of single-use plastic. Sustainability is a very critical issue. What I like most about how it's evolving is kids and schools are doing much better than us as adults. Children are coming
ready and awareness.
Kids are coming back with the right kind of sensibilities and value systems from the schools. They are forcing us to respond to them in the right way. So we have in terms of sustainability, it is about using your resources better, leaving the world a better place than how you inherited it.
So as a designer, you make very conscious choices with what materials you choose, what manufacturing, what, you know, how it should be packaged, how it should be distributed. and how to have the least you know carbon footprint. So from what I understand from you is the youth is teaching us now in a way to be more conscious, you know,
And be more responsible, use resources more judiciously, more efficiently, optimize the usage, leave the world a better place than how you inherited it in the first place.
Okay. Right. So there was one more trend which we've you know we've discussed about it as well. More and more products are becoming portable, and again that has to do with the lifestyle of people now, and they are becoming multifunctional, right? So what used to be just one radio before is now become the radio is also in the phone, but you know not only this example but so many products we see. And why is that happening? Of course we've discussed it, but maybe you can throw some light on why is it happening. And the designers of tomorrow, how they have to adapt to make multifunctional products.
So, classic example, Kodak used to be the biggest manufacturer of cameras. Very fast, a mobile manufacturing company became the largest manufacturer of cameras, and those cameras disappeared from the market. So the mobile phone is also a camera now. So multi-utility products. I always wanted to have products that come in a package where the package itself had a utility value and I could use the package for something else. So something of that sort. So
the packaging is not discarded, the packaging is also utilized for something else.
So yes, multi-utility products, people in this generation are a little more mobile, they are less rooted, they don't spend a lot of time in one location, they stay in one place for a shorter duration of time.
They're more nomadic
than we were, so they don't have too many possessions, and they would not want to have too many sort of objects to carry.
Objects to carry around all the time. So it'll be a fantastic thing to have just a few gadgets, a few objects
that support their life, and they double up for many other utility values. So that leaves a lesser pressure on the environment and demand on nature and material. So it leaves a smaller carbon footprint and all of that.
So they, at the same time, they have to be very portable.
Very portable. So that's a trend that should catch on.
It's work in progress. We are eagerly looking at how it's evolving.
Evolving, yeah.
Things to learn.
Yeah. Because every now and then I see new concepts on all these, you know, product design websites like Yanko or Producture or Design. And we see new ideas getting a lot of likes on which are those which are multifunctional, you know.
Right.
So a backpack that folds into a seat or a seat which becomes a bag, things like that.
Right.
So I once helped a lady design a child stroller which was also a backpack, backpacking system. So she was a nomadic person and she would travel around the globe, and that would, you know, so things like that.
Nice.
So, yes.
So that is one more trend which now I think will affect product design, yeah. And along those lines, I was thinking, people have also changed their behavior because the whole market, you know, the whole scenario is evolving towards a product service system. Let's take Uber for example, or Ola, or just an example of renting an electric bike or renting a bicycle. This concept did not. I mean, renting a bicycle has been there, but maybe not so much of electric scooters. If you see in the US, like Lime and Bird, or even in India, Yulu also tried that. I think there are some companies in Bangalore. So how has product design changed? We'll need to address these issues, you know, with a product service system, because people don't want to buy things now, as you said. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's entirely a different demand on how products need to be designed, because
for a very long time, we were trying to reach the last mile and the person who's going to use the product. We were going global, from global to we became local, and we sort of started adapting it to, cultural sensitivities and localized preferences and all of that. And technology was to an extent permitting us to do that. We could have shorter batch productions and we could cater to a different set of demands from a different user segment. This model will see a change because now you don't have possessions and you have rentable objects, which means that we are now asked to design for one size fits all.
For more durability and
maybe more ruggedness, it's not a personal possession anymore.
Yeah.
And I don't personalize it. I don't write my name on it, and it's not part of me anymore.
Correct.
where a bike or a cycle used to be part of my personality, now it's everybody's. So that design idiom will be very different. So that evolution is taking place right in front of us. It's evolving.
Products have to be more and more rugged. More and more rugged. Not only with mobility, many things are rented now.
Yeah. True. And this product service spoke about
also giving rise to a lot of work opportunities. Mm. Because it is not just the end product, but the entire system behind it that supports this business model. Mm. So there are deployments that make this model work. There are hardware deployments, there's a system deployment, there are admin work, there is IT work, there's a whole lot of sort of other ancillary systems and procedures that's taking root right now. So it's a fascinating work in progress, and it's fascinating to see so much work being generated for people around. So
also the new gig economy is kind of, you know, linked to a product service system where people work only for that gig, you know, it's a side gig. So they work like the delivery boy, for example. He works a few hours a day, and he's not employed. Neither is the company having a contract with him.
Right. People have multiple jobs. They do delivery in the evening, do a different job. They have multiple skills.
They live that life. There's more respectability for work, all kinds of work. And I just was thinking, when you mentioned yesterday, we had a telephonic chat, you spoke about some of these issues. Mm. And I was thinking, like, there is no mobility solution for food delivery, which is so much omnipresent all around us. A bike which has been designed for sports or for two people to ride on is not meant for food delivery.
Yeah.
So
that
mobility solution is also coming up.
Yeah, right. So from what I understand is this, because of this multifunctional portable, you need ruggedness, durability, and you need to have a one size fits all kind of model. You have to think universally now again.
So not so much size really,
but
the design definitely, one design that fits all.
So there is one more trend that we are seeing. It has been, you know, always in the news, but I don't know if it's a trend really now anymore, or it's a macro trend. I can't define it. Is this manufacturing technique, which is 3D printing, you know, 3D printing. So to our people, maybe, you know, to the audiences, some of them may not know what is 3D printing. So I'll just summarize for them, because they are aspirants, you know, many of them are aspirants for design. So it's a new manufacturing technique. It's not really new, but it is trending, in which you can make anything, almost anything, straight from a computer model. This is the simplest way I can explain 3D printing, because 3D printing has so many different kinds of processes. It has SLA, SLS, FDM, and so unlike conventional manufacturing, where you have a piece of raw material that you put under a machine and you cut it out, here what happens is you just make a CAD model and you connect it to the 3D printer, and it makes to you layer by layer, and you get a product. So there are a lot of you might not appreciate, but designers and manufacturers, and we appreciate this development a lot. And it has impacted the design, industrial design profession a lot. So can you tell us about it?
So a very fascinating development. We personally, in our practice, use a lot of 3D printing because we work for defense, and we produce objects, devices in small numbers, which means it cannot go into the traditional manufacturing process, otherwise it would be very expensive. So which is fascinating, because 3D printing is seen as expensive, and we are using 3D printing to reduce cost. Correct. That's one. The other thing is, 3D printing is evolving very fast. Newer technologies are coming up every day. The design community, design fraternity, is still learning to use the potential of 3D printing, which means a product which is specifically designed for that process is still taking shape. So we tend to design for the traditional manufacturing process, but when we don't have those sufficient numbers, then we design for 3D print. But if you could design only for 3D printing process, it would give us a lot more freedom with what we could do with design. Mm. So the shapes and forms possible are
we have to leverage on
unbelievable, we can leverage that
strength of the process.
Like you said, you know, it's not only the technology, the processes, but also materials that are possible. Yes. Like a few years ago, you couldn't 3D print clay. Today you can 3D print in clay.
You can can play with.
So yeah, that is that is
so that is fascinating.
Yeah,
we tend to use very high tech material because we are in the defense arena.
We need more strength and robustness, so that kind of thing.
So there, you think it still
needs improvement when it comes to strength, the functional prototypes.
Yes. Yeah. A lot of the technologies are still not available everywhere geographically. We still access facilities that are in other parts of the country in certain locations only. They're very high-tech solutions.
So yes, at the technology front work is being done, at the design front work is being done, newer methods of production are happening. We can print entire assemblies. We cannot, now we don't need to print parts and then assemble them. We can actually print assemblies that have moving parts. So it opens up enormous possibilities of what we could do with design. It will change the palette of design and the business of design, and also the business of manufacturing. So although the technology, the core of the technology is 30 years old, it is now that it is sort of really
coming to shape and coming to its own.
Have you seen some food 3D printers?
Yes.
Yeah. I was quite fascinated. Yeah, they're trying and. I think some companies are even making 3D printed chocolate, so you give them a shape and you get a, you know, that.
That can be easily done.
Yeah.
Body parts are being 3D printed.
Body parts.
Medical parts,
prosthetic limbs.
I think at the moment, wherever there is customization required, so let's say some implant or a dental implant or a, you know, something in the body, I think it's done.
Yes. And all I need to do is shape the object on a computer application, and I fire a print just like I'm printing a paper. I'm printing that object, and it just, you know, prints itself. So it's beautiful.
It's beautiful
to even to look at and imagine something of that nature. It's almost like science fiction.
I've also seen it's been for a while now that they print the entire houses. You know, there are colonies being built.
They've done that. It's very experimental. Personally, what I am really looking at is for 3D print to transform manufacturing.
So when I am able to manufacture in huge numbers, large numbers using printing technology,
mass customized,
and I could reach out, Hari, to you as a customer. I could take a feedback, and Hari wants a little difference in his product, and I'll say Hari's file takes a different, gets a different print. And then fire that print. So, you know, I customize it only for you. That would be fascinating.
That is, fascinating. Yeah. I think a few years ago they have been ambitious about it, but let's see. So, after this is the last topic trend, which is something that again has to do with our lifestyles and the millennials and, you know, the entire movement of minimalism and sustainability and all that is also health and well-being. You know, today more people, today we are kind of conscious, maybe because of the you know, cause and effect, the things that we did that now we have to take care of, than before. So there are a lot of products, industrial products, which are for healthcare. Let's say even a fitness band to start with, or diabetes, or you know, there are small products that used to be once upon a time only in a hospital or in a clinic, now at home. So what do you think of this health and well-being as a trend?
First thing that comes to my mind is this is a segment of industry that is always active and evolving. So there is no dearth of work there. There is no recession there. Health and fitness is something that people and companies will always invest in. So
any kind of medical product,
fitness product is good for the industry, for the design fraternity. We discussed IoT before. So devices that monitor your well-being used to be standalone devices. Now it's very easy for devices to do a shake hand with each other. So then going to the gym and wearing a fitness band could get interconnected. And your health monitoring could be dynamic. You don't have to go to a doctor to get your blood pressure checked. So it could be an unobtrusive little device embedded somewhere. I'm not saying in body, but on you. And it could do dynamic checking throughout the day. It will interlink all of these performances and feedback. It will give you a summary of your status of well-being. And it could be read by a doctor perhaps.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to do that.
Yeah, but still,
a qualified person does that. And it could real-time monitoring of your well-being, and you could do predictive
sort of corrective measures. You could predict what
preventive
could go
health care.
Sort of, you could predict what could go wrong,
and you could do preventive measures before something seriously goes wrong.
That's
so
that's
maybe
good.
A little
cautious.
Small intervention can save you from a incisive sort of surgery or something.
So
that's a different insight. I didn't think about
right,
that.
Right.
I've always been wondering of personal health care, but that data being stored on the cloud, and now that data is accessible over a period of time, and to have preventive health care.
So I recently saw a
treadmill. I recently saw a treadmill that had those sensors embedded, and it could connect to me on devices on me. So then my identity and that my performance get interlinked, and when I do the treadmill routine, all of the parameters then get embedded in my app. So that app then monitors everything that I do through the day. Steps I climb,
that's interesting. And with this whole integration, you know, IoT, medical products and so many other things, we are seeing a new trend that is, it's not like new, but more and more industrial designers have also to think of user experience on apps, because everything is coming finally to a phone or to a screen. And you've done so much with HMI, with interaction design. Can you tell us what are the new things with interaction design influencing product design?
So in fact, we are living in a world that's evolving so fast that everything is changing.
I'm repeating that sentence again and again. I find that I'm being repetitive, but it's so true that we designed a device recently, and that was full of hardware controls, very complex, 100 odd controls on a little handheld controller. And the next version within a year had only touchscreen interfaces, the same device.
That interface can just be updated over a software.
Yes.
Software
so
update.
Dematerialization is happening.
Virtualization is happening. It is moving to the virtual world. The difference between software and hardware is sort of, you know, becoming a little blurry.
Disappearing.
So now I can toggle a software state from a hardware.
Like these days, all automobiles are coming with two or three driving modes. So they are like a switch that give a different engine parameter. So those engine parameters are just engine maps residing on the same computer on the in the car, inside the car. You're just using a hardware control to toggle between these three states. So it's software and hardware. Tomorrow it will be voice control. Thereafter it will be gesture. And you'll just signal that, and then the mode will change. So
I think voice, a few years ago it was used to be only user interface and user, it was still visual, now it's moving to voice.
So I buy saplings from a nursery near my house. So this guy is not very literate probably, but he uses Google. So I came out with a list of botanical names because I wanted specific planting material, and he just used the voice command on Google. He didn't have anything to do with the spelling or the knowledge of botany.
Nothing.
He
asked me what the name is. He said, Google. And he said, voice command. He said, and he saw the picture. He said, I didn't do that one.
So voice command is not alien. So now all your interfaces, machine interfaces will change. And it's actually changing. I'm right now working on these things that are taking shape and changing. And I'm learning as I'm going. Learning to absorb that change and doing it. So it's very, very fascinating.
We are looking forward to very interesting times, I think, in industrial design, especially.
It is not a static, stagnant, boring profession. It is to be in. This is the time to be in this profession, to really have fun with technology.
So I don't know if you want to add any more points, or then we can see if we can have a short round of question and answer, because we have people from the webinar who can ask us. So I see one question from Sushant. How are design schools adapting to these changes happening in the industry?
You're the best person.
I can answer that. What we are doing is we have been evolving in the last 4 or 5 years. We're trying and integrating more and more electronics and smart systems into the curriculum. So it's no longer only about mechanisms and you know, manufacturing. It's also about Arduino programming, hardware programming, and sensors, and you know, that is one thing that we're trying to do. We are trying to, I mean, I can only speak for my school, but we can see that trend happening all over the world. Everyone is also tuning into AR and VR, which is augmented reality and virtual reality. Yeah, that's the question. Yeah. Second question I see is, with these trends, what would be new skills needed for product design professionals? Yeah, can you with
so
these,
sort
with
of,
these
you know, extension of what you said, more technology oriented skills, but more awareness of what impact it has on life and environment. That's something that the education itself will have to impart, the training itself will have to impart to the program.
Do you think something like humanities, which has to, you have to think of what impacts technology, how technology and humans are interacting, that is also something?
With artificial intelligence coming into being, which is like human-like intelligence in machines. So machines will do a different set of tasks. So up until now, machine would have done repetitive tasks, but you could now trust machines to do decision making that is discretionary. So, so they can take their own decision based on certain value judgments. We as designers need the skill to be able to sort of assimilate that thought in our environments. We can only then make sense of what is this technology is offering to us. Otherwise, we'll stay with the technology, do rudimentary things for a few years, and then really start harnessing its true potential. So, design skills will have to add more skills to the designer. He is not just a sculptor anymore.
He's not a sculptor. He's not an artist anymore.
He thinks with his mind.
And he has to kind of visualize. He's more of a visualizer in terms of you know, what the next thing could happen.
So as I'll
go back to that chef analogy. So he's a visualizer, he is an aggregator, but he understands all of these things. So nobody can be an expert in every domain, but the designer has to sit on the top of the pyramid and be an aggregator of all of these skill sets. So then again, if you are a skilled chef, then knowing more about the ingredients may not necessarily result in a better recipe, but your ability to blend all of those ingredients is what will define your skill and proficiency as a designer. So yes, you would have to know all of these skill sets, but again, you'll have to be an aggregator and work with a multidisciplinary team.
You have to be on your toes. I think you have to learn things very quickly and also unlearn things, and then
you move along constantly. You need to be
open minded. Okay. So our next question is from Dhanush. I think this has to do with product design as a discipline. He's asking us, how important is science and math know-how for product design? Is the course very technical? So
what do you think? Is the course very technical? I don't think it's technical. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
But a designer would know his stuff. And if it's technology, he would know the heart of the technology. He will understand what the technology is built out of and what it can do and where it can go. Because he applies the power of imagination to the basic building blocks of that technology. So if there is maths. So there is no choice
about it. Yeah. But it's not just number crunching, it's everything to
think about. I agree with you. From what I've experienced with practicing design, or you know, also having curriculum, it's not something that you don't learn mathematics like you learn in engineering. You don't learn partial differential equations or you know, Leibniz theorem. You don't learn a lot of theory, but when it comes to math in industrial design, but you need to understand basics of physics, of course, you know, and you need to be you need to have a intuitive attitude towards science. This is how things work. If you remember that book, How Stuff Works, that is what mostly I think, if you know, so principle wise, if they understand, I think it should be fine.
You are a man of science, you're also an artist, you're both taken together.
Yeah.
I think that's how it is.
Yeah.
So,
The next question is from Arnav. What is the influence of new technologies in product design? I think we kind of answered.
On that, 3D printing, artificial intelligence, virtual reality.
I think AR, VR we could talk about.
So
we've talked already about 3D printing and IoT.
I'll give you a small example of how virtual reality has been used by one of the companies that we are sort of kindly
partly associated with. So they've built large assembly lines that they install in remote locations. Mm-hmm. It's a very complex engineering product that does very high-end engineering processes in that assembly line. I won't go into details of that, but when they build that system, they need to calibrate all the sensors and parts. They had to do it on-site, and it used to be a very tedious task. Mm-hmm. What they've done is they've done the entire calibration thing in a virtual environment. And they created a virtual environment, and they found out what calibrations is required, and the hardware is being calibrated simultaneously. Mm-hmm. On top of that, when they install it on-site, they take the client on a virtual tour through the 2 kilometer long assembly line, and the owner of
the creator of the assembly and the end user owner of the assembly line both are together in that virtual environment. They create an avatar
of the owner, and the owner is in that virtual environment explaining the product to his client. So that virtual environment has been created, and you know, it's really shortening up the delivery time, increasing the efficiency of deployment, and creating a tool which is so fascinating to work with. It's almost like gaming. Kids are, you know, always so up and running with gaming. It's the same experience that you create in a real environment. So
fascinating use of the technology.
Yeah, this VR is really picking up also for maintenance. I think maintenance is also one
maintenance
domain.
And training.
Training
so
mostly.
In defense, they create a lot of VR models for training.
So complex robotic applications, dismantle, and if you take out the part. So I can actually use VR environment, go inside it and take out a part and tell them that this is how it works and those are the controls, this and that. So training modules are being created on VR.
Also, maybe hazardous
environments where you have a big furnace where you want to check really, then you can do it with VR. From what I have experienced now is there are some softwares where you can visualize things in three-dimensional space popping out. You know, this is a trend which we also see with our students. They use Unity and a couple of other, you know, gadgets and software and apps. But now it's not just seeing 3D. We are used to seeing, I mean, everyone is so far using 3D but still on a flat screen, you know. So now with VR you can see the model come to life when you wear the headset. So it is also changing the way designers are visualizing and presenting.
Very true.
Presenting.
And,
Very soon you may not need those glasses.
Yeah.
We already have holographic projections
where
you can actually see the projection, although it's a technology which is not yet perfected. Maybe some companies may tend to disagree with me, but it is still expensive, difficult to access, but it is already there. So holographic display, so you can have entire objects, assemblies, people displayed right in front of you, and they're virtual, they're not real. So how real will they be going ahead? I'm sure they'll become very real.
Very real, yeah.
For now they are projections.
And we see also that with a lot of CAD CAM companies.
Yes.
Earlier we used to have, you know, everything drawn by hand. Then it was the same drawings on computer aided design. Then it's in 3D. Now the same thing is going virtual.
Yes.
So it's coming to 3D space. That could be the one. So there's one question. Can I switch from computer science engineering to product design in the masters? I think yeah. Well, you can also give your comments. I think that is possible, but you need to understand from what I understand, you know, can tell you is manufacturing processes and materials are something that are so much, you know, at the core of industrial design. And if a computer science engineer can learn that before he joins a master program, that's better, because there's such a short time to do in the 2 years that you.
But Harit, do the institutes
taking students, I think they do at the postgraduate level,
yeah,
not at the
postgraduate
level. You do have students coming out, coming in from various streams, and also probably also from the
computer science
background. So the, it is definitely a possibility.
It's a possibility, but
In the light of so much stiff competition, we rather select a person who has knowledge of materials and manufacturing. Well, if he's a computer science engineer who knows it, then it's fair game, you know. Otherwise, otherwise the mechanical engineer or manufacturing guy is
we'll
have an edge. The next question is, how does AI and machine learning impact product design? So I think we answered that.
More or less answered that.
Yeah, we've answered that question.
AI is human-like intelligence. So processes that were not automated up until now
will also tend to get automated. So it's a different world we are looking at. And virtual reality we just discussed.
We just talked about this.
Yes. So there's another question. What is the role of product design in service industry? We've touched upon this in product service system.
Upon this briefly. Service industry.
The touch points for us are what is visible to us. So the delivery boy, the food delivery person is a touch point for that system. But there is an entire elaborate backend system which has hardware deployment, like a food delivery app also has hardware deployment at every food vendor installation. So there is hardware, there is IT, there is workspace environment, there are gadgets, there's mobility. And there is an app. So what we normally tend to see as an app is actually an entire deployment on across dimensions.
Yeah.
So yes, so we have to look at it from that perspective also.
Yeah, and there's another question. Why is sustainability important in product design? I think we've touched it.
The product designer takes those hard decisions.
That is why. Because he guides the client on most of the times, or he is the decision maker on how should resources be used, where to put your money. Sustainability.
Also with respect to choice of materials, choice of processes, that is something we spoke about.
Yeah, right.
How his design, you know, if he chooses plastic, then of course it's going to be injection molding. Or if he chooses metal, then it will not, it will not spoil the environment. Probably it will go back into the environment.
So the right
selection and sustainability fundamentally is to make your resources last longer.
Yeah, even
design for manufacturing assembly, if parts can be removed out easily,
yes,
they are more sustainable because when they're discarded, things can be removed and separated.
Right.
So there I would say mechanical fasteners, like you put a metal part with a plastic part is easier to dismantle than something that is glued,
right,
or composites, for example. It's very,
Those
choices.
Sustainability is becoming an ideology. So a designer has to imbibe those ideologies and work for the betterment of the world for the generations to come. So product designers will impact everything from design, from choices to preferences to manufacturing to consumption, to everything. So
that's
designer has a lot of responsibility on his shoulders, his or her shoulders.
Then we have a question.
What is the interaction between user experience design and product design? So
as we said, the control environments are evolving very fast.
So what used to be an app or a user and interface is fast becoming the control interface for everything. Even the hardware has the same user interface, touchscreen or otherwise. So that demarcation has blurred now. So as we discussed, multi-skilled, more skills to be acquired, or maybe a more robust team with all kinds of skill sets. Yes.
I think more or less, we're done with questions, and I think we had a very nice talk and very nice discussion. So I'd like to thank all our participants for this, for coming, joining in this webinar. And I'd thank you a lot, Parag, to come here and, share all your views and experiences and share with us also the trends.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
It's an honor to be in this institution. I've come here before. And it's great to work with an academic institution. Academics plays in a very important part in our lives, and yeah, we should all contribute to it.
Okay.
Thanks. Thanks a lot. Yeah.
I make the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker. I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.